to start a play about kings and cardinals in speaking costumes and intellectuals with embroidered mouths with me. If a king or cardinal had done the prologue, he would have had the right material. And an intellectual would have shown enough majestic meanings, colored propositions, and closely woven liturgical stuff to dress the House of Lords. But this, is this a costume? Does this say anything? Barely covers one man's nakedness. A bit of black material to push old Adam down to being a common man. Oh, if they let me come out naked, I could have shown you something of my own, which would have told you, without words, something I've forgotten. Old Adam's muffled up. Well, for a proposition of mine, I need a costume. Matthew. The household steward of Sir Thomas More. There's company to dinner. All right. A common man. A 16th century butler. Now the 16th... The 16th century is the century of the common man. Like all the other centuries. And that is my proposition. That is Sir Thomas More.
The wine, please, Matthew.
Yes, there, Sir Thomas.
Is it good?
Bless you, sir. I don't know.
Bless you too, Matthew.
But every man has his price.
No, no, no.
Master Richard Rich.
But yes, in money too.
No,
no, no.
Or pleasure, titles, women, bricks and mortar. There's always something.
Oh, childish.
Well, in suffering, certainly.
Buy a man with suffering.
Impose suffering and offer him escape.
Oh, for a moment I thought you were being profound.
Good evening, Matthew.
Evening, sir.
No, not a bit profound. It then becomes purely a practical question of how to make him suffer sufficiently.
Who recommended you to read, Signor Machiavelli? No, who?
Master Cromwell.
Ah. He's a very able fellow.
And so he is.
Yes, yes, I say he is. He's very able.
And he will do something for me, he says.
I didn't know you knew him.
Pardon me, Sir Thomas, but how much do you know about me?
Whatever you've let me know.
I've let you know everything.
Richard, you should go back to Cambridge. You're deteriorating.
Well, I'm not used. Do you know how much I have to show for 7 months' work?
Work!
Work! Waiting's work when you wait as I wait. Hard. For 7 months, that's 200 days, I have to show the acquaintance of the cardinal's outer doorman, the indifference of the cardinal's inner doorman, and the cardinal's chamberlain's hand in my chest. Oh, also, one half of a good morning delivered at 50 paces by the Duke of Norfolk. Doubtless he mistook me for someone.
He was very affable at dinner.
Oh, everyone's affable here. Also, the friendship of Sir Thomas More? Or should I say acquaintance?
Well, say friendship.
Well, there! A friend of Sir Thomas and still no office? There must be something wrong with him.
I thought we said friendship. The Dean at St. Paul's offers you a post. With a house, a servant, and £50 a year.
What post?
At the new school.
A teacher.
A man should go where he won't be tempted. Well, look, Richard. See this? Look. Look.
Beautiful.
Italian, do you want it?
Why?
No joke. Keep it. Or sell it.
Why, thank you. thank you, but...
You'll sell it, won't you?
Well, yes, I will.
And buy what?
Some decent clothes.
Ah.
I want a gown like yours.
You should get several for that, I would think. It was sent to me a little while ago by some man. Now he's put a lawsuit into the court of request. It's a bribe, Richard.
Oh. So you give it away, of course.
Yes. Well, I'm not going to keep it.
To me?
Well, I'm not keeping it, and you need it. But, of course, if you feel it's contaminated...
Oh, no. I'll risk it.
Yes, I thought so. But, Richard, in office, they'll offer you all sorts of things. I was once offered a whole village with a mill and a manor house and, well, heaven knows what else. A coat of arms, I shouldn't be surprised. Why not be a teacher? Well, you'd be a fine teacher. Perhaps even a great one.
And if I was, who would know it?
Well, you, your pupils, your friends, God. Not a bad public, that. And a quiet life.
You say that.
Richard, I was commanded into office. It was inflicted on me. Can't you believe that?
It's hard.
Be a teacher.
It was magnificent!
Lord Norfolk, Earl Marshal of England.
I tell you, he stooped from the clouds, Alice!
Yeah.
Lady Alice, my master's wife.
I tell you, he stooped.
He didn't.
God damn it, he did.
Couldn't.
He does.
It's not possible.
But often.
Never.
Well, damn my soul.
Come down, Meg.
Lady Margaret, my master's daughter. Lovely, really lovely.
Matthew, get about your business. We shall settle this, my lord. We shall put it to Thomas. Thomas? No falcon could stoop from a cloud, could it?
Oh, I don't know, my dear. Well, it sounds unlikely. I have seen falcons do some very splendid things.
But how could he stoop from a cloud? He couldn't see where he was going.
You see, Alice, you are ignorant of the topic. A real falcon don't care where he's going.
Thank you, Thomas. Anyway, I was talking to Meg. Meg, it was the first cast of the day. The sun was behind us. And from side to side of the valley, like the roof of a tent, was solid mist.
Oh, mist!
Well, mist is cloud, isn't it?
No.
The opinion of Aristotle is that mists are an exhalation of the earth.
He stooped 500 feet like that, like an act of God, didn't he, Thomas?
He's tremendous.
Tremendous!
Did he kill the heron?
Oh, well, the heron was clever, but it was a royal stoop, though! If you could ride, Alice, I'd show you.
I can ride, my lord.
No, you'll make yourself ill.
And I shall bet 30 shillings that I shall see no falcons stoop from no cloud.
Done!
Alice, you can't ride with him.
God's body, Thomas, remember who you are. Am I a city wife?
No, indeed. You just lost 30 shillings, I think. There are such birds. And the heron got home to his chicks, Meg, so everything was satisfactory.
Yes.
And what was that of Aristotle's, Richard?
Nothing, Sir Thomas. It was out of place.
I've never found much use in Aristotle myself, not practically. Great philosopher, wonderful mind.
Exactly, Your Grace.
Eh?
Oh, Master Rich is newly converted to the doctrines of Machiavelli.
Oh, no! No!
Oh, the Italian. Nasty book, I hear.
Very practical, Your Grace.
Oh, you've read it? Wonderful girl, Thomas, but where are you going to find her husband?
Oh, where indeed?
The doctrines of Machiavelli have been largely mistaken, I think. Indeed, properly apprehended, he has no doctrine. Master Cromwell has the
You know Cromwell?
Slightly, Your Grace.
The Cardinal's secretary?
Never!
No.
It can't be!
The Cardinals. It's impossible.
Not possible.
It's a fact.
When, Howard?
2-3 days.
A farrier's son.
Well, the Cardinal's a butcher's son, isn't he?
It'll be up quick and down quick with Master Cromwell.
Did you know this?
No.
Do you like Master Cromwell, Master Rich? He's the only man in London if he does.
I think I do, Lady Alice.
Good. Then you don't need my help now.
Oh, Sir Thomas, if only you knew how much rather I'd yours than his.
Speak of the Cardinal's secretary, and the Cardinal appears. He wants me, now.
At this time of night?
The King's business.
the Queen's business.
More than likely, Alice, more than likely.
What's the time?
11 o'clock, sir.
Is there a boat?
Waiting, sir.
Then you'll go to bed. If you'll excuse me, Your Grace, Richard, now you'll go to bed.
Dear Lord, give us rest tonight, or if we must be wakeful, cheerful, careful only for our soul's salvation, for Christ's sake, Amen.
And bless our Lord the King.
And bless our Lord the King. Amen.
Howard, are you at Richmond?
No, down the river.
Oh, then good night. Your Grace, here's a young man desperate for employment. Something in the clerical line?
Well, if you recommend him.
No, I don't recommend him, but I point him out. He's at the New Inn. Can you take him there?
All right, come on.
Your Grace?
We'll hawk it Hounslow, Alice!
Wherever you like!
Sir Thomas. Thank you.
Be a teacher. Alice, the ground is hard at Hounslow.
Eh? Oh, that's where the cardinal crushed his bum. Good night.
Margaret.
Yes?
Go to bed.
Yeah. It was a gift, Matthew. Sir Thomas gave it to me. He gave it to me.
Very nice present, sir.
Yes. Well, good night, Matthew.
Sir Thomas has taken quite a fancy to you, sir.
Here.
Thank you, sir. Well, that one will come to nothing. My master, Thomas More, will give anything to anyone. Some say that's good, and some say that's bad. But I say he can't help it, and that's bad. Because someday someone's going to ask him for something that he wants to keep, and he'll be out of practice. There must be something that he wants to keep. That's only common sense.
Half past one. Where have you been?
1 o'clock, Your Grace. I've been on the river.
Since you seem so violently opposed to the dispatch for Rome, I thought you'd like to look it over.
Well, thank you, Your Grace.
Before it goes.
Your Grace is very kind. Thank you.
Well, what do you think of it?
It seems very well phrased, Your Grace.
The devil, it does. And apart from the style, Sir Thomas?
It's addressed to Cardinal Campeggio.
Yes?
Not to our ambassador.
Our ambassador's a ninny.
Your Grace appointed him?
Yes. I need a ninny in Rome, so that I can write to Cardinal Campeggio.
It's devious.
It's a devious situation.
There must be something simple in the middle of it.
I believe. You believe that? You're a constant regret to me, Thomas. If you could just see facts flat on without that horrible moral squint. With just a little common sense, you could have been a statesman.
Oh, Your Grace flatters me.
Don't fribble. Thomas, are you going to help me?
If Your Grace will be specific.
Ah, you're a plodder. Take you all together, Thomas. Your scholarship, your experience, what are you? Come here. The king.
Yes.
Where's he been, do you know?
Ah, Your Grace.
Oh, spare me your discretion. He's been to play in the mud again.
Indeed.
Indeed. Indeed. Are you going to oppose me? He's gone in. All right. We'll plod. The king wants a son. What are you going to do about it?
I'm quite certain the king needs no advice from me on what to do about it.
Thomas, we're alone. I give you my word, there's no one here.
I didn't suppose there was,
Your Grace. Oh, sit down! Do you favor a change of dynasty, Sir Thomas? Do you think two tutors is sufficient?
For God's sake, Your Grace.
Then the king needs a son. I repeat, what are you going to do about it?
I pray for it daily.
Oh, God's death, he means it. That thing out there is at least fertile, Thomas.
Yes, but she's not his wife.
No, Catherine's his wife. She's as barren as a brick. Are you going to pray for a miracle?
There are precedents.
Yes. All right. Good. Pray. Pray by all means. But in addition to prayer, there is effort. My efforts to secure a divorce. Have I your support, or have I not?
A dispensation was granted so that our king might marry Queen Catherine for state reasons. Now we are to ask the Pope to dispense with his dispensation, also for state reasons?
I don't like plodding, Thomas. Don't make me plod longer than I have to. Well?
Then, clearly all we have to do is approach His Holiness and ask him.
I think we might influence His Holiness's answer.
Like that?
Like that and another way.
I've already expressed my opinion on
then
that.
Then good night! Oh, your conscience is your own affair. But you're a statesman. Do you remember the Yorkist Wars?
Very clearly.
Let him die without an heir, and we'll have them back again. Let him die without an heir, and this peace you think so much of will go out like that. Very well, then. England needs an heir. Certain measures, perhaps regrettable, perhaps not. There is much in the church that needs reformation, Thomas. All right, regrettable. But necessary to get us an heir. Now explain how you, as Counselor of England, can obstruct those measures for the sake of your own private conscience.
Well, I believe when statesmen forsake their own private conscience for the sake of their public duties, they lead their country by a short route to chaos. And we shall have my prayers to fall back on.
You'd like that, wouldn't you? To govern the country by prayers.
Yes, I should.
I'd like to be there when you try. Who will? Who will put his neck in this after me? You, Tunstall, Suffolk?
Tunstall for me.
Aye, but for the king. What do you think of my secretary, Master Cromwell?
Cromwell?
You'd rather do it yourself.
Me, rather than Cromwell.
And come down to earth, Thomas. And until you do, bear in mind, you have an enemy.
Where? Your Grace?
Here, Thomas.
As Your Grace pleases.
As God wills.
Perhaps, Your Grace.
More. You should have been a cleric.
Like yourself, Your Grace.
Just going home myself, sir.
Then find me another boat.
Oh, bless you, sir. I expect you'll make it worth my while.
Footman, have you a license?
Eh? Oh, bless you, sir. Yes, I've got a license.
Then you know that the fares are fixed. Why, it's Sir Thomas.
Good morning, Master Cromwell. You worked very late this morning.
I'm on my way to the Cardinal.
Ah, yes. You are to be felicitated. Good morning, Master Secretary.
Yes.
If it's felicity to be busy in the night.
It is.
Felicitations, then.
You have just left him, I think.
Yes, I have.
You left him in his laughing mood, I hope.
On the whole, I would say no. not laughing.
I'm sorry. Well, I am one of your multitudinous admirers, Sir Thomas. A penny halfpenny to Chelsea, boatman.
They're coming, man, they say, sir.
Do they? Well, where's your boat?
Just along the wharf, sir.
Sir Thomas More.
Senor Chapuis, you're up very late, Your Excellency.
So is the Cardinal, Sir Thomas.
Yes, he sleeps very little.
You have just left him, I think?
You are correctly informed, as always.
I will not ask you the subject of your conversation?
No, of course not.
Sir Thomas, I will be plain with you, plain that is so far as the diplomatic decencies permit. My master Charles, King of Spain. My master Charles, the King of Spain, feels himself concerned in anything concerning his blood relations. He would feel himself insulted by any insult to his mother's sister. I refer, of course, to Queen Katarina. The King of Spain would feel himself insulted by any insult offered to Queen Katarina.
His feelings would be natural.
Sir Thomas, may I ask if you and the Cardinal parted, how shall I say, amicably?
Amicably, yes.
In agreement?
Amicably.
Say no more, Sir Thomas, I understand.
I hope you do, Your Excellency.
You were a good man.
I don't see how you can deduce that from what I've told you.
A nod is as good as a wink to a blind horse. I understand. You are a good man. Dominus vobiscum.
Spiritu tuo.
Some people think boats stay afloat on their own, sir. But they don't. They cost money.
Take anchor rope, sir. You may not believe me, but for my little skiff is a penny a fathom. And when the young wife is...
I'll pay you what I always pay you. The river looks very black tonight. They say it's silting up. Is that true?
Not in the middle, sir. There's a channel there getting deeper all the time.
Well, how's your wife?
She's losing her shape, sir. Losing it fast.
Well, so are we all.
Yes, sir. It's common.
Take me home.
That I will, sir. From Richmond to Chelsea, a penny halfpenny. From Chelsea to Richmond, a penny halfpenny. From Richmond to Chelsea, it's a quiet float downstream. From Chelsea to Richmond, it's a hard pull upstream, and it's a penny halfpenny either way. Whoever makes the regulations doesn't row a boat. Again.
Oh, Matthew. Oh. Is Lady Alice in bed?
Yes, sir.
Lady Margaret?
No, sir. Master Roper's here.
At this hour? Oh, who let him in?
He's a hard man to keep out, sir.
Well, where are they?
Here, Father.
Oh. Thank you, Matthew. Good morning, William. It's a little early for breakfast.
I haven't come for breakfast, sir.
Will wants to marry me, Father.
Well, he can't marry you.
Sir Thomas, I'm to be called to the bar.
Oh, congratulations, Roper.
My family may not be in the palace, but
oh,
in the city...
Oh, the Ropers were advocates when the Moors were selling pewter. There's nothing wrong with your family. There's nothing wrong with your fortune. Nothing wrong with you, except you need a clock.
I can buy a clock, sir.
Roper, the answer's no and will remain no so long as you're a heretic.
That's a word I don't like, Sir Thomas.
It's not a likable word. It's not a likable thing.
The church is heretical. Dr. Luther's proved that to my satisfaction.
Luther is an excommunicate.
From a heretic church. Church, it's a shop. Forgiveness by the florin. Job lots now in Germany. And divorces.
Divorces?
Oh, half England's buzzing with that.
Half England? The Inns of Court may be buzzing. England doesn't buzz so easily.
It will. And is that a church? Is that a cardinal? Is that a pope? Or antichrist? Look, what I know, I'll say.
You've no sense of the place.
You no sense of the time.
I am...
Roper, 2 years ago, you were a passionate churchman. Now you're a passionate
Lutheran. We must just pray that when your head's finished turning, your face is to the front again.
Don't lengthen your prayers with me, sir.
Oh, one more or less. Is your horse here?
No, I walked.
Well, take one from the stable and go back home. Go along.
May I come again?
Yes, soon.
Good night, sir.
Is that final, Father?
Oh, as long as he's a heretic, Meg, that is absolute. Nice boy, though. Terribly strong principles. I thought I told you to go to bed.
Yes. Why?
Because I wanted you to go to bed. You're very pensive.
You're very gay. Did the Cardinal talk about the divorce?
You know, I think we've been on the wrong track with Will. Well, there's no use arguing with a Roper. Old Roper was just the same.
Did he?
Let Roper think he was going with the current, and boy, he'd turn around and start swimming the opposite direction. What we need is a really substantial attack on the church.
We're going to get it, aren't we?
Meg, I'll not have you talk treason. And I'll not have you repeat lawyer's gossip. A lawyer myself, I know what it's worth.
Thomas!
Oh, now see what you've done.
Oh, young Roper! I have just seen young Roper on my horse!
Yes, he'll bring it back, dear. He's been to see Margaret.
Oh, why don't you beat that girl?
No, no. She's full of education, and that's a delicate commodity.
Hmm, and more's the pity.
Yes. But it's there now, and think what it cost.
I'm sorry. Margaret, hot water.
Oh, I'm sorry you were awakened, chick.
I wasn't sleeping very deeply. Thomas, what did Wosley want?
Young Roper asked me for Margaret.
What? Impudent?
Yes, wasn't it?
Oh, you old fox. Thomas, what did Wosley want?
Oh, he wanted me to read a dispatch.
Is that all?
Latin dispatch?
Oh, you don't want to talk about it.
No.
Norfolk was speaking for you as Chancellor before he left.
He's a dangerous friend, then. Wolsey's Chancellor. God help him. We don't want another. Oh, I don't want this.
Drink it! Great men get colds in the head just the same as commoners.
That's dangerous leveling talk, Alice. Beware of the tower.
Drink it.
I will. I'll drink it in bed.
Would you want to be Chancellor?
No.
That's what I said. But Norfolk said if Wolsey fell,
if
then
Wolsey
would...
fell, the splash would swamp a few small boats like ours. There'll be no new Chancellors while Wolsey lives.
Whether we follow tradition in ascribing Wolsey's death to a broken heart, or accept Professor Lockholm's less feeling diagnosis of pulmonary pneumonia, its effective cause was the king's displeasure. He died at Leicester on 29 November 1530 while on his way to the Tower under a charge of high treason. England's next Lord Chancellor was Sir Thomas More, a scholar and, by popular repute, a saint. His scholarship is supported by his writings. His saintliness is a quality a little less easy to establish. But from his willful indifference to realities, which were obvious to quite ordinary contemporaries, it seemed all too probable that he had it.
Bridge, what brings you to Hampton? I came with the Duke last night, Master Cromwell. They're hunting again.
It's a kingly pastime, Master Rich. I'm glad to see you found employment. You're the Duke's secretary, are you not?
My work is mostly secretarial.
Or is it his librarian you are?
I do look after his grace's library, yes.
Oh, well, that's something. And I don't suppose you're bothered much by his grace in the library. It's odd how differently men's fortunes flow. My late Master Wolsey died in disgrace, yet here I am in the king's own service. And there you are in a comparative backwater, yet the new Lord Chancellor's an old friend of yours.
He isn't really my friend.
Oh, I thought he was.
In a sense, he is.
Well, I always understood that he set you up in life.
He recommended me to the Duke.
Ah, yes. And are you very attached to His Grace's library, or would you be free to accept an office?
Have you offices in gift?
I am listened to by those who have.
Master Cromwell, what is it exactly that you do for the king?
Yes, I should like to know that, Master Cromwell.
Ah, Signor Chapuis. You know His Excellency, Rich, the Spanish ambassador, the Duke of Norfolk's librarian.
But how should we introduce you, Master Cromwell, if we had the happiness?
Oh, sly. You see how sly he is, Rich? Well, I suppose you would call me the king's ear. It's a useful organ, the ear. But in fact, it's even simpler than that. When the king wants something done, I do it.
Ah, but then why these justices, chancellors, admirals?
Oh, they are the constitution. Our ancient English constitution. I merely do things.
For example, Master Cromwell.
Oh, beware these professional diplomats. Well, for example, next week at Deptford, we are launching the Great Harry. 1,000 tons, 4 masts, 66 guns, an overall length of 175 feet. It's expected to be very effective. All this you probably know, and what you may not know is that the king himself will guide her down the river. Yes, the king himself will be her pilot. Well, he will have assistance, of course, but he himself will be her pilot. He will have a pilot's whistle upon which he will blow, and he will wear in every respect a common pilot's uniform, except for the material, of course, which will be cloth of gold. These innocent fancies require more preparation than you might suppose, and someone has to do it. Meanwhile, I do prepare myself for higher things. I stock my mind.
Alas, Master Cromwell, don't we all? This sheep, for instance, it has 56 guns, by the way, not 66, and only 40 of them heavy. After the launching, I understand the king will take his barge to Chelsea.
Yes.
To?
Sir Thomas More's.
Will you be there?
Oh, no. They'll talk about the divorce. The king will ask him for an answer.
He has given his answer.
The king will ask him for another.
Sir Thomas is a good son of the church.
Sir Thomas is a man.
Isn't that his steward now?
Yes, I believe it is. Well, good day, Your Excellency.
Good day, Master Cromwell.
Good day.
Sir Thomas doesn't talk about it, sir. He doesn't talk about it to his wife, sir.
This is worth nothing.
But he doesn't talk about it to Lady Margaret. That's his daughter, sir.
So?
So he's worried. Frightened.
Sir, he goes all white when it is mentioned.
Sir.
Are you coming in my direction, Rich?
No.
I think you should, you know.
I can't tell you anything.
Well, Sir Thomas rises at 6, sir, and prays for an hour and a half.
Yes.
During Lent, sir, he lived entirely on bread and water.
Yes. He goes to confession twice a week, sir. Parish priest, Dominican.
He is a true son of the church.
That he is, sir.
What did Master Cromwell want?
Same as you, sir.
No man can serve two masters, steward.
Indeed not, sir. I serve only one.
Good. Simple man. Here. Peace be with you.
And with you, sir.
Our Lord watch you.
You too, sir.
That is a very religious man.
Matthew. What did Signor Chef Weiss want?
I've no idea, sir.
What did you tell him?
I told him that Sir Thomas says his prayers and goes to confession, sir.
Why that?
That's what he wanted to know, sir. I mean, I could have told him any number of things about Sir Thomas, that he has rheumatism, that he prefers red wine to white, easily seasick, fond of kippers, afraid of drowning, but that's what he wanted to know, sir.
What did he say?
He said that Sir Thomas is a very good churchman, sir.
Well, that's true, isn't it?
I'm just telling you what he said, sir. Oh, Master Cromwell went that way, sir.
Did I ask you which way Master Cromwell went?
The great thing's not to get out of your depth. What I can tell you is common knowledge. But now they've given money for it, and everyone wants value for his money. They'll make a secret out of it now to prove they haven't been built. They'll make it a secret by making it dangerous. Oh, and I can't touch the bottom. I'm going to go deaf, blind, and dumb. And that is more than I earn in a fortnight.
Oh, no sign of him, my lord.
That's Buddy Ellis. He must be found.
He must be in the house.
He's not in the house, Mother.
He must be in the garden then.
He takes things too far, Alice.
Do I not know it?
Well, then badly.
I know that too.
Where is your master? Oh my god! Yes, fool! And if the king arrives in the chancel,
it's not my fault!
Thomas will get no good of it. This is not how Wolsey made himself great.
Thomas has his own way of doing things, my lord.
Yes, yes, Thomas is unique. But where is Thomas?
Father!
Thomas!
Sir!
Oh!
My lord chancellor! What sort of fooling is this? Does the king come to visit you every day?
No, but I go to Vespers most days.
He's here!
But isn't this visit meant to be a surprise?
For you, yes, not for him. You intend to meet the king dressed as a parish clerk, my lord chancellor? A parish clerk? You offend the king and his council.
The service of God does not dishonor any office. Trust me, my friend, I do not belittle the honor his majesty is doing me. Oh, that is a lovely dress, Alice. Oh, so's that, Margaret. I'm a dowdy bird, aren't I? Well, we're all ready now.
Oh, by God, you can be harebrained.
What is the matter?
What whim possessed you?
It was not a whim.
Your second best stockings.
It's not.
Oh, enough is enough.
Oh, good.
Father.
No. Your majesty does my house more honor than I fear my household can bear.
No ceremony, Thomas. No ceremony. A passing fancy, I happened to be on the river. Look! Mud!
We do it in better style, Your Grace, when we come by the road.
The road? There's the road for me, Thomas! The river! My river! By heaven, what an evening! Lady Alice, I fear we come upon you unexpectedly.
Oh, no, Your Grace. I mean, that is, yes, Your Grace, we are ready for you. Ready to entertain Your Grace, that is.
This is my daughter Margaret, sire. She has not had the honor to meet Your Grace.
Why, Margaret? They told me you were a scholar.
Answer, Margaret.
Among women, I pass for one, Your Grace.
Antiquone mor latine and antoniense.
When we docet parted, Domine.
Bene, optimus est. Dera camera linguam quoque te docuit?
Graecum, non se mi docet parted, meus semi patris amicus, Johannes Colitus, sancti Paula Decanus. In literis graecis tamen, non minus quam latinis as magistri minuto discipulis stultitia.
Take care, Thomas. Too much learning is weariness of the flesh. And there is no end to the making of books. Can you dance, Margaret?
Not well, your grace.
Well, I dance superlatively. See that? That's a dancer's leg, Margaret. Hey, Norfolk! Now, that's a wrestler's leg, but I can throw him. Shall I show them, Howard? Shall I?
No, your grace.
You are gentle. That's good. You shall read to me. No, you shall read to me. Lady Alice, the river's given me an appetite.
Oh, if your grace would share a very simple supper.
It would please me. I'm something of a scholar to you, Margaret. Did you know that?
Why, all the world knows your grace's book, asserting the seven sacraments of the church.
Ah, yes. Between ourselves, your father had a hand in that, eh, Thomas?
Here and there, your grace, but in a minor capacity.
He seeks to shame me with his modesty. On second thought, Lady Alice, Thomas and I will follow. Wait! Margaret, are you fond of music?
Yes, your grace.
Blow. Blow. Louder.
Oh!
I brought them with me. Lady Alice takes them in.
Yes.
Do you know this, Thomas?
No, your grace.
Shh. I launched a ship today, Thomas.
Yes,
listen, man, listen. The Great Harry. I steered her under sail.
Your grace has many accomplishments.
A great experience, Thomas.
Yes, your grace.
I'm a fool.
How so, your grace?
What else but a fool to live in a court in a licentious mob when I have friends with gardens?
Your grace.
No court, Sir Thomas, no ceremony. Be seated. You are my friend, are you not, Thomas?
Your Majesty.
And thank God I have a friend for my Chancellor. Ready to be friends, I trust, than he was to be Chancellor.
My knowledge of my own poor abilities, Your Grace.
I will judge of your abilities, Thomas. Did you know that Wolsey named you for Chancellor?
Wolsey?
Aye. Before he died, Wolsey named you, and Wolsey was no fool.
He was a statesman of incomparable ability, Your Grace.
Was he? Was he so? Then why did he fail me? 'Twas villainy then. Yes, villainy. Be seated. I was right to break him, Thomas. He was a proud man, pride right through, and he failed me in the one thing that mattered. The one thing that matters then or now. And why? He wanted to be Pope. Yes, he wanted to be a Bishop of Rome. Well, let me tell you something, Thomas, and you can check this for yourself. It was never merry in England when we had cardinals amongst us. But look now! I shall forget the feel of that great tiller under my hands. I took her down to Dorset's bank, went about and brought her up to Tilbury Road. A man can sail clean round the world in that ship.
Some men could, Your Grace.
Touching this matter of my divorce, Thomas, have you thought about it since last we talked?
Of little else.
Then you see your way clear to me.
That you should put away Queen Catherine, sire? Alas, I see so clearly that I cannot come with your grace, that my endeavor is not to think of it at all.
Then you have not thought enough! Great God, Thomas! Why do you hold out against me the very desire of my heart, the very wick of my heart?
There is my right arm. Take your dagger and saw it from my shoulder, and I will laugh
and be thankful if by that means I can come with your grace with a clear conscience.
I know. Thomas, I know.
Crave pardon if I offend.
Speak then.
When I took the great seal, your majesty promised not to pursue me on this matter.
So I break my word, Master More! I'm joking! I joke roughly! It's hard to think I'm a rough young fellow. Be seated. That's a rose bay. Oh, we have one like it at Hampton. Not quite so red as that, though. I'm in an excellent frame of mind. You must understand, Thomas. I stand in peril of my soul. 'Twas no marriage. She was my brother's widow. Leviticus, thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of thy brother's wife. Leviticus, chapter 18, verse 16.
Yes, your grace, but Deuteronomy...
Deuteronomy's ambiguous!
Your grace, I'm not fit to meddle in these matters. It seems to me a matter for the Holy See.
Thomas, does a man need a pope to tell him when he sinned? It was a sin, Thomas, I admit. And I repent. And God has punished me. I have no son. Son. After son, she's borne me, or dead at birth, or dead within the month. Never saw the hand of God so clear anything. I have a daughter. She's a good child, a well-set child, but I have no son. It is my bounden duty to put away the queen and all the popes. Bastard Saint Peter shall not come between me and my duty. How is it you cannot see this? Everyone else can.
Then why does your grace need my poor support?
Because you're honest. What's more to the point, you're known to be honest. And there are those like Norfolk who follow me because I wear the crown. And there are those like Master Cromwell who follow me because they are jackals with sharp teeth, and I am their lion. And then there's a mass that follows me because it follows anything that moves. Then there is you.
I'm sick to think how much I must displease your grace.
No, man. I respect your sincerity. Respect. Oh. Man, it's water in the desert. The music they played, yeah, had a certain... Well, tell me what you thought of it.
Could it have been your grace's own?
Discovered! And now I'll never know your true opinion. And that's irksome, Thomas. For we artists, though we love praise, yet we love truth better.
Then I will tell your grace truly what I thought of it.
Speak then.
To me, it seemed delightful.
Thomas, I chose the right man for Chancellor.
I must in fairness add that my taste in music is reputedly deplorable.
Your taste in music is excellent. It exactly coincides with my own. Ah, music. Music! Send them back without me, Thomas. I will live here in Chelsea and make music.
My house is at your grace's disposal.
Thomas, you understand me. We shall stay here and make music.
Will you, your grace, honor my roof after dinner?
Yes. I expect I'll bellow for you.
Oh, my wife will be so pleased. She loves to hear your
yes.
grace.
Yes. Yes. Touching this other matter, Thomas, I'll have no opposition.
Your grace?
No! Opposition, I say! No opposition! Your conscience is your own affair! But you are my chancellor! I see how it will be! The bishops will oppose me! The full-fed, hypocritical princes of the church! As for the pope, am I to burn in hell because the bishop of Rome, with the kingdom of Spain's knife to his throat, mouths me to Deuteronomy! Hypocrites! They're all hypocrites! Mind they don't take you in, Thomas! Lie low if you will! But I'll brook no opposition! No words! No sayings! No letters! No pamphlets! Mind that, Thomas! No writings against me!
Your grace is unjust! I am your grace's loyal minister. If I cannot serve your grace in this great matter of the queen...
I am no queen! Catherine is not my wife! And those that say she is are not only liars, but traitors! Mind that, Thomas!
Am I a babbler, your grace?
You are stubborn! If you could come with me, man, you are the one I would soonest raise with my own hand.
Your grace overwhelms me.
What's that?
8 o'clock, your grace.
Lift yourself up, man. Have I not promised? Shall we eat?
If your grace pleases, what will your grace sing for us after dinner?
8 o'clock, you said. Thomas, the tide will be changing. I was forgetting the tide. I'd better go.
I'm sorry, your grace.
Oh, I must catch the tide, or I'll not get back to Richmond until no. Don't come. Tell Norfolk, Lady Alice. The tide will be changing. I was forgetting the tide. I must go. To tell the truth, Lady Alice, I was forgetting in your haven here how time flows past outside. Affairs call me to court, so I give you my thanks and say good night.
Good night,
good night,
your grace.
Your grace.
What's this? You've crossed him.
Somewhat.
Why?
I couldn't find the other way.
You're too nice altogether, Thomas. Oh,
woman, mind your house.
I am minding my house.
Well, Alice, what would you want me to do?
Be ruled. If you will not rule him, be ruled.
I neither could nor would rule my king. But there's a little area where I must rule myself. It's very little, less to him than a tennis court. Look, it was 8 o'clock. At 8 o'clock, Lady Anne likes to dance.
Oh.
I think so.
And you stand between them?
I? What stands between them is a sacrament of the church. I'm less important than you think, Alice.
Oh, stay friends with him, Thomas.
Whatever can be done by smiling, you can rely on me to do.
You don't know how to flatter.
I flatter very well. My recipe is beginning to be widely copied. It's the basic syrup with just a soupçon of discreet impudence.
I wish he'd eaten here.
Yes! We shall be living on that simple supper of yours for a fortnight.
Alice, set your mind at rest.
This is not the stuff of which martyrs are made.
Thomas.
Oh, no.
Well, Roper, what do you want? Oh.
William, I told you not to.
Meg, I'm not easily told.
I asked you not to.
Meg, I'm full up to here.
It's not convenient.
Must everything be made convenient? I'm not a convenient man, Meg. I've got an inconvenient conscience.
Joshua's trumpet! One note on that brass conscience of yours, and my daughter's walls are down.
You raised her, sir.
Have you been here long? Are you in the king's party?
No, sir, I am not in the king's party. It is of that I wish to speak to you. My spirit is perturbed.
Is it, Will? Why?
I've been offered a seat in the next parliament. Ought I to take it?
No. Well, that depends. With your views on church reform, I would have thought you could do yourself a lot of good in the next parliament.
My views on the church, I must confess, since we last met, my views have somewhat modified. I modify nothing concerning the body of the church. The money changers in the temple must be scourged from thence with a scourge of fire if that is needed. But an attack on the church herself, no. I see behind that an attack on God.
Roper.
The devil's
work. Roper.
To be done by the devil's minister.
For heaven's sake, Roper, remember my office.
Oh, if you stand in your office.
I don't stand on it. But there are certain things I may not hear.
Sophistication. It is what I was told. The court has corrupted you, Sir Thomas. You are not the man you were. You have learned to study your convenience. You have learned to flash.
Ha! There, Alice! You see? I have a reputation for it!
God's body, young man! If I were the Chancellor, I would have you whipped!
Master Rich is here, Sir Thomas.
Oh. Good evening, sir. Good evening, Richard.
Lady Alice. Lady Margaret.
Good evening, Master Rich.
You know Will Roper, the younger.
By reputation, of course.
Good evening, Master...
Rich.
Oh. Oh.
You've heard of me?
Yes.
In what connection? I can't imagine what you may have heard. I sense I'm not welcome here.
Why, Richard, have you done something to make yourself not welcome?
Why? Do you suspect me of it?
I shall begin to.
Cromwell is asking questions about you. About you particularly. He's continually collecting information.
Yes, I know that. Wait a minute, Matthew.
That's one of his sources.
Of course. That's one of my servants.
But Señor Chapuis, the Spanish ambassador,
collects information, too. That's one of his functions.
You look at me as though I were an enemy.
Why, Richard, you're shaking.
I'm adrift. Help me.
How?
Employ me.
No.
Employ me?
No.
I would be steadfast.
Richard, you couldn't answer for yourself, even so far as tonight.
Arrest him.
Yes!
For what?
He's dangerous!
For libel, he's a spy.
He is! Arrest him!
Father, that man's bad.
There's no law against that.
There is God's law.
Then God can arrest him!
Sophistication upon sophistication.
No! Sheer simplicity. The law, Roper, the law. I know what's legal, not what's right. I'll stick with what's legal.
Then you would set man's law above God's.
No, far below it. But let me draw your attention to a fact. I'm not God. The currents and eddies of right and wrong, which you find such plain sailing, I can't navigate. I'm no voyager. But in the thickets of the law, oh, there I'm a forester. I doubt if there's a man alive who could follow me there. Thank God.
While you talk, he's gone.
And go he should if he were the devil himself until he broke the law.
So now you'd give the devil benefit of law?
Yes! What would you do? I'd cut a great road through the law to get after the devil.
I'd cut down every law in England to do that.
Oh? And when the last law was down and the devil turned around on you, where would you hide, Roper? The laws being all flat. This country's planted thick with laws from coast to coast. Man's laws, not God's. And if you cut them down, and you're just the man to do it, do you really think you could stand upright in the winds that would blow then? Yes. I give the devil benefit of law for my own safety's sake.
This is what I have long suspected. This is the golden calf. The law's your god.
Oh, Roper, you're a fool. God's my god. But I find him rather too subtle. I don't know where he is or what he wants.
My God wants service to the end and unremitting, nothing else.
Are you sure that's God? Sounds like Moloch. But indeed it may be God. And whoever hunts for me, Roper, God or devil, will find me hiding in the thickets of the law. And I'll hide my daughter with me, not hoist her up on the mainmast of your sea-going principles. They put about too nimbly.
That was harsh.
What's happened here?
He can't abide a fool, that's all. Be off.
Hide you? Hide you from what?
He made no mention of hiding me, you noticed. I've got too fat to hide, I suppose.
You know he meant us both, Mother.
But from what?
I don't know. I don't know if he knows. He has not said one simple direct word to me since this whole divorce came up. It is not God who's gone subtle, it's him.
Roper, oh, that was harsh. Your principles are excellent, the very best kind.
No,
truly, your principles are fine. Now look, we must make a start on all that food.
Father, can't you be plain with us?
Look, I stand on the wrong side of no statute and no common law. I have not disobeyed my sovereign. I truly believe no man in England is safer than myself. And I want my supper. Will, we'll need your assistance. There's an excellent Burgundy, if your principles permit.
They don't, sir.
Well, have a little water in it.
Just the water, sir.
My poor boy.
Thomas, why does Cromwell collect information about you?
I'm a prominent figure. Someone somewhere is collecting information on Cromwell. Now look, we must make a start. There's a stuffed swarm, if you please. Will, I trust you with my life, but not your principles. You see, we speak of being anchored to our principles. And yet, if the weather turns nasty, you up with your anchor and put it down where the fishing's better and there's less wind. And look, we say, I'm anchored to my principles.
The loyal subject. A pub. A publican. Oh, he's the deep one, that Sir Thomas More. Deep. Takes a lot of education to get a man as deep as that. And a deep nature to begin with, too. The likes of me can hardly be expected to follow the process of a man like that. Can we? Ready? Right. Ready, sir!
Is this a good place for a conspiracy innkeeper?
You asked for a private room, sir.
Yes, I want one without too many little dark corners.
I don't understand you, sir. Just the four corners that you see.
You don't understand.
No, sir.
Do you know who I am?
No, sir.
Don't be too tactful, innkeeper.
I don't understand, sir.
When the likes of you are too tactful, the likes of me begin to wonder who's the fool.
I just don't understand you, sir.
The master statesman of us all. I don't understand. All right. Get out. Come on. Yes, it may be that I am a little intoxicated, but not with alcohol. I have a strong head for that. With success. And who has a strong head for success? None of us gets enough of it, except for kings, and they're born drunk.
Success? What success?
Guess.
Collector of revenues for York.
Oh, you do keep your ear to the ground, don't you? No.
What then?
Sir Thomas Paget is retiring.
Secretary to the council.
Tis astonishing, isn't it?
Well, no. I mean, one sees it's logical.
No ceremony, no courtship. Be seated, as His Majesty would say. Yes, you see how I trust you.
Oh, I would never repeat or report a thing like that.
What kind of thing would you repeat or report?
Well, nothing said in friendship. May I say friendship?
If you like. Do you believe that? That you would never repeat or report anything, etc.?
Yes.
No, but seriously.
Why, yes.
Rich. Seriously.
It would depend what I was offered.
Don't say it just to please me.
No, it's true. It would depend what I was offered.
Everybody knows it. Not many people can say it.
Well, there are some things one wouldn't do for anything, surely.
That idea is like these lifelines they have on the embankment. Comforting, but you wouldn't expect to have to use them. Well, congratulations.
On what?
I think you'd make a good collector of revenues for York Diocese.
Is it in your gift?
It
will be.
What do I have to do for it?
Nothing. It isn't like that, Rich. There are no rules. With rewards and penalties, so much wickedness purchases so much worldly prospering. Are you sure you're not religious?
Almost sure.
Get sure. No, it's not like that. It's much more a matter of convenience. Administrative convenience. The normal aim of administration is to keep steady this factor of convenience, and Sir Thomas would agree. And normally, when a man wants to change his woman, you let him if it's convenient, and prevent him if it's not. Normally, indeed, it's of so little importance that you leave it to the priests. But the constant factor is this element of convenience.
Whose convenience?
Oh, ours. But everybody's, too. However, in the present instance, the man who wants to change his woman is our sovereign Lord Harry, by the grace of God, the eighth of that name. Which is a quaint way of saying that if he wants to change his woman, he will. So that becomes the constant factor. And our job as administrators is to make it as convenient as we can. I say our job on the assumption that you'll take this post at York I've offered you.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
It's a bad sign when people are depressed by their own good fortune.
I'm not depressed.
You look depressed.
I'm lamenting. I've lost my innocence.
Oh, you lost that some time ago. If you've only just noticed, it can't have been very important to you.
That's true. Why, that's true. It can't.
We experience a sense of release. Do we, Master Rich? An unfamiliar freshness in the head, as of open air?
Collector of revenues isn't bad.
Not bad for a start. Now, our present Lord Chancellor. There's an innocent man.
The odd thing is, he is.
Yes, I say he is. The thing is, his innocence is tangled in this proposition that you can't change your woman without a divorce, and you can't have a divorce unless the Pope says so. And although his present holiness is judged even by the most liberal standards, a strikingly corrupt old person, yet still he has this word, Pope, attached to him. And from this quite meaningless circumstance, I fear some degree of
administrative inconvenience.
Just so. This goblet that he gave you, how much was it worth? Come along, Rich. He gave you a silver goblet. How much did you get for it?
50 shillings.
Could you take me to the shop?
Yes.
Where did he get it? It was a gift from a litigant, wasn't it?
Yes.
Which court? Chancery? No, don't get drunk. In which court was this litigant's case?
Court of Requests.
There. That wasn't too painful, was it?
No.
That's all there is. Then you'll find it easier next time.
What application do they have, these tidbits of information you collect?
None at all, usually.
But sometimes.
Well, there are these men, you know, steadfast, upright men, who want themselves to be the constant factor in the situation, which of course they can't. The situation rolls forward in any case.
So what happens?
If they've any sense, they get out of its way.
And if they haven't any sense?
What, none at all? Why then, they're only fit for heaven. But Sir Thomas has plenty of sense. He could be frightened.
Don't forget, he's an innocent Master Cromwell.
I think we'll finish there for tonight. After all, he is the Lord Chancellor.
You won't find him easy to frighten. You've mistaken your man this time. He doesn't know how to be frightened.
Doesn't know how to be frightened.
Why, then he never put his hand in a candle, did he?
You enjoyed that! You enjoyed it!
The intermission started early in the year 1530.
It's now the middle of May, 1532. 2 years. During that time, a lot of water flowed under the bridge, and one of the things that came floating along on it was the Church of England, that finest flower of our island genius for compromise, that system peculiar to these shores, the despair of foreign observers, which deflects the torrents of religious passion down the canals of moderation. That's very well put. Typically, this great effect was achieved not by bloodshed, but by simple act of parliament. Only an unhappy few were found to set themselves against the current of their times, and in so doing to court disaster. For we are dealing with an age less fastidious than our own, imprisonment without trial and examination under torture were common.
Will, must you wear those clothes?
Yes, sir, I must.
Why?
The time has come for decent men to declare their allegiance.
And what allegiance are those designed to express?
My allegiance to the church.
Well, you look like a Spaniard.
All credit to Spain, then.
You wouldn't have lasted 6 months in Spain. You'd have been burned alive in Spain during your heretic period.
I suppose you have the right to remind me of it. That chain of office that you wear is a degradation.
I've told you, Will. If the bishops in convocation submitted this morning, I'll take it off. It's no degradation. Great men have worn this.
Well, when do you expect to hear from the bishops?
About now. I was promised an immediate answer.
I don't see what difference convocation can make. The church is already a wing of the palace, is it not? The king is already the supreme head of the church, is he not?
No.
You are denying the act of supremacy?
No. The act of supremacy states that the king
is the supreme head of the church.
Is supreme head of the church in England so far as the law of God allows. How far the law of God allows remains a matter of opinion, since the act doesn't state it.
A legal quibble.
Call it what you like. It's there, thank God.
Very well. In your opinion, how far does the law of God allow this?
I'll keep my opinion to myself, Will.
Yes, I'll tell you mine.
Don't! If your opinion's what I think it is, it's high treason. We remember that you have a wife now, and they have children.
Why must he remember that?
To keep myself discreet.
Then I'd rather you forgot it.
You're either idiots or children.
Or saints, my lord.
Oh, Father, Signor Chapuis has come to see you.
Your Excellency.
Or saints, my lord. Or saints.
That's it, of course. Saints. Will, turn your head a bit. Yes? Yes, I do think I detect a faint radiance. Will, you should have told us.
Come, my lord. You two at this time are not free from some suspicion of saintliness.
I don't like the sound of that, Your Excellency. What do you require of me? What, Your Excellency?
May I not come simply to pay my respects to the English Socrates, as I see your angelic friend Erasmus calls you?
Yes, well, I shall think of something presently to call Erasmus. Socrates. I've no taste for hemlock, Your Excellency, if that's what you require.
Heaven forbid.
Amen.
Must I require anything? After all, we are brothers in Christ, you and I.
A characteristic we share with the rest of humanity. You live in Cheapside, senor. To make contact with a brother in Christ, you need only to open your window and empty a chamber pot. You needn't come to Chelsea. William, the Spanish ambassador is here on business. Would you mind?
Oh no, I protest.
He is clearly here on business.
No, but really, I protest. Dominus vobiscum, filii mei.
Et cum spiritu tuo, excellences.
And how much longer will we hear that holy language in these shores?
'Tisn't holy, Your Excellency. Just old.
My lord, I cannot believe you will allow yourself to be associated with the recent actions of King Henry in respect of Queen Katharina.
Subjects are associated with the actions of kings willy-nilly.
The Lord Chancellor is not an ordinary subject. He bears responsibility for what he's done.
Have you considered that what has been done badly
might have been done worse with a different chancellor.
Believe me, my lord, your influence in these policies has been my search for, and where it has been found, it has been praised. But there comes a point, does there not?
Yes, there comes such a point.
When the sufferings of one unfortunate lady swell to an open attack on the religion of an entire country, that point has been passed. Beyond that point, Sir Thomas, one is not merely compromised, one is in truth corrupted.
What do you want?
Rumor has it that if the church in convocation has submitted to the king, you will resign.
I see.
Supposing rumor to be true, would you approve?
Approve, applaud, admire.
Why?
Because it would show one man, and that man known to be temperate, unable to go further with this wickedness.
And that man known to be Chancellor of England, too.
Believe me, my lord, such a signal would be seen. Yes, my lord, it would be seen and understood.
By whom?
By half of your fellow countrymen. Sir Thomas, I have just returned from Yorkshire and Northumberland, where I have made a tour.
Have you indeed?
Things are very different there, my lord. There, they are ready.
Ready for what?
Resistance.
Resistance by what means? By force of arms?
We are adjured by St. Paul to don the arms of Christ when the occasion warrants.
In the metaphorical arms, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation. Do you mean a metaphorical resistance?
He shall flee the iron weapons, and the bow of steel shall strike him through.
I see.
Sir Thomas. Excuse me, sir. His Grace, the Duke of Norfolk. It's all over,
One
sir.
One moment, Roper, I'll do this. Oh.
I was on the point of leaving, Your Grace. Just a personal call. Was trying to borrow a book, but without success. You sure you have no copy, my lord? Then I'll leave you. Gentlemen, ladies.
Sir Thomas.
I'll do it, Roper. Thomas, the convocation has knuckled under. They're to pay a fine of £100,000, and we've severed the connection with Rome.
The connection with Rome is nice.
The connection with Rome.
Your Grace, this is quite certain, is it?
Yes. Funny company, Thomas.
I can assure you it's quite unintentional. He doesn't mean to be funny. Help me with this.
Not I.
Shall I, sir?
No. Thank you, Will. Alice?
Hell's fire. God's blood and body, no! Sun and moon, Master Moore, you are taken for a wise man. Is this wisdom to betray your ability, abandon practice, forget your station and duty to your kin, and behave like a printed book?
Margaret, will you?
If you want.
There's my clever girl.
Well, Thomas, why? Make me understand. Because I'll tell you, from where I stand, this looks like cowardice.
All right. I will. This isn't reformation. This is war against the church. Our king, Norfolk, has declared war against the pope. Because the pope will not declare that our queen is not his wife.
And is she?
I'll answer that question for one person alone. The king. I'm that in private, too.
Man, you're cautious.
Yes. I'm cautious. I'm not one of your hawks.
All right, we're at war with the Pope. The Pope's a prince, isn't he?
Yes.
And a bad one.
Bad enough. But the theory is, he's also the vicar of God, the descendant of St. Peter, our only link with Christ.
A tenuous link.
Oh, tenuous indeed.
Does this make sense? You'll forfeit all you've got, including the respect of your country, for a theory?
The apostolic succession of Pope is... a theory. Yes. It's a theory. Well, you can't touch it. You can't feel it. It's a theory. But what matters to me is not whether it's true or not, but that I believe it is true. Or rather, not that I believe it is true, but that I believe it is true. I trust I've made myself obscure.
Perfectly.
Good. Obscurity is what I've in need of now.
Thomas, this isn't Spain, you know.
Have I your word that what we say here is between ourselves and has no existence beyond these walls?
Very well.
And if the king should command you to repeat what I have said?
I should keep my word to you.
Then what has become of your oath of obedience to the king?
You lay traps for me?
No. I show you the times.
Why do you insult me with these lawyer's tricks?
Because I'm afraid.
And here's your answer. The king accepts your resignation very sadly. He is mindful of your goodness and past loyalty, and in any matter concerning your honor and welfare, he will be your good lord. So much for your fear.
You will convey my humble gratitude.
I will. Good day, Lady Alice. I'd rather deal with you than your husband.
Oh, Howard! Senor Chapuis tells me that he's just completed a tour of the North Country. He thinks we'll have trouble there. So do I.
Yes, what kind of trouble?
The church. What? The old church, not the new one. It's very strong up there. I'm serious, Howard. Keep an eye on the border come spring, and bear in mind the old alliance.
We will. We do. As for the Spaniard, Thomas, it might relieve your mind to know that one of Secretary Cromwell's agents accompanied him on the tour.
Oh, well, if Master Cromwell has matters in hand.
He has.
I can imagine.
But thank you for the information. It's good to know you still have some vestige of patriotism.
That's a remarkably stupid observation, Norfolk.
Well, there's an end of you. What will you do now? Sit by the fire and make goslings in the ash?
Oh, not at all, Alice. I expect I'll write a bit. I'll write. I'll read. I'll think. I think I'll learn to fish. I'll play with my grandchildren once son Roper has done his duty. Alice, shall I teach you to read?
No, by God.
Son Roper, you're pleased with me at least.
Sir, you have made a noble gesture.
A gesture? Will, I couldn't continue. I wasn't able to continue. I would have if I could have. I made no gesture. Oh, God. I hope it's understood. I make no gesture. Alice, you don't think I would do this to you for a gesture? That's a gesture! That's a gesture! I'm no street acrobat to make gestures. I'm practical.
Sir, you belittle yourself. This was not practical. This was moral.
Oh. Oh, now I understand you, Will. Morality is not practical. Morality is a gesture, a complicated gesture we learn in books. That's what you think, isn't it, Alice? And you, Margaret?
It is for most of us,
oh,
Father.
Oh, if you're going to plead humility, you're cruel. I have a cruel family.
Yes, you can fit the cap on anyone you like. I know that well enough. If there's cruelty to be found in this house, I know where to look for it.
No, Mother.
Oh, you would walk on the bottom of the sea and think yourself a crab if he suggested it. And you would dance him off to the tower. You'd dance him off to the block like David with a harp, scattering hymn books in his path. Poor silly man. Do you think they'll leave you here to learn to fish?
If we govern our tongues, they will. Now look, I have a word to say on that. I have made no statement. I've resigned, that's all. All on the king's supremacy, on the divorce he'll then grant himself, on the marriage he'll then make. Have you heard me make a statement?
No.
And if I am to lose my rank and fall to housekeeping, I want to know the reason, so make a statement now.
No.
Oh.
Alice, it's a point of law. Accept it from me, Alice, that in silence is my safety under the law. But my silence must be absolute. It must extend to you.
In short, you don't trust us.
A man would have to be half-witted not to trust you. But look, I'm the Lord Chief Justice. I'm Cromwell. I'm the King's head jailer. And I take your hand, and I clamp it on the Bible, on the blessed cross. And I say to you, woman, has your husband made a statement on these matters? Now, on peril of your soul, remember, what's your answer?
No, no.
And so it must remain. Oh, it's only a lifeline. We shan't have to use it, but it's comforting to have. No, no. Once they see I'm silent, they'll ask nothing better than to leave me silent. You'll see.
Sir, the household's in the kitchen. They want to know what's happened.
Oh, yes, yes. We'll have to talk to them, Alice. They'll mostly have to go, my dear. But not before we found them places.
Oh, we can't find places for them all?
Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Tell them so.
God's death comes on us quickly.
What about you, Matthew? It's a smaller household now. Well, for you, a smaller wage, I'm afraid. Will you stay?
Don't see how I could then, sir.
Well, you're a single man.
Well, yes, sir, but I mean I've got...
Yes, quite right. why should you? I shall miss you, Matthew. I shall miss you.
No. You never have much time for me, sir. You see through me, sir. I know that.
I shall miss you. I shall miss you.
Now, damn me! Isn't that them all over? Miss? He? Miss me? What's in me for him to miss? Oh! Darren! I nearly fell for it! Matthew, would you kindly take a cut in your wages? No, Sir Thomas, I cannot! That's it. And that's all of it. All right, he's down on his luck. I'm sorry. I don't mind saying it. I'm sorry. Bad luck. If I had any good luck to spare, he could have some. I wish we could all have good luck all the time. I wish we had wings. I wish rainwater was beer, but it isn't. And what with not having wings and having to walk on 2 flat feet and good luck and bad luck being just exactly even Stevens and rainwater being water, don't you complicate the job by putting something in me for me to miss! I did, you know. I nearly fell for it.
But he makes no noise, Master Secretary. He's silent. Why not leave him silent?
Not being a man of letters, Your Grace, you perhaps don't realize the extent of his reputation. This silence of his is bellowing up and down Europe. Now, may I recapitulate? He reported the Spaniards' conversation to you, informed of a Spaniards' tour of the North Country, warned of a possible rebellion there.
He did.
We may say, then, that he showed himself hostile to the hopes of Spain.
Well, that's what I say.
Bear with me, Your Grace. Now, he opposes Spain, he supports us. Surely that follows. Or do you see some third alternative?
Oh, no, that's the lineup, all right. And may I say, Thomas Moore
will line up on the right side.
Yes, crank he may be, traitor he is not.
With a little pressure, he may be got to say so. And that's all we'll need. A brief declaration of loyalty for the present administration.
I still say let sleeping dogs lie.
The king does not agree with you.
What sort of pressure do you think you can bring to bear?
I have evidence that Sir Thomas, during the period of his judicature,
accepted bribes.
What? God damn it, he's the only judge since Cato that didn't accept bribes. When was there last a chancellor whose possessions, after 3 years in office, totaled £100 and a gold chain? Richard,
it is, as you imply, common practice. However, a practice may be common and remain an offense. This offense could send a man to the Tower.
Oh, I don't believe it.
Ah, Richard. You know His Grace, of course?
Oh, indeed, yes. We're old friends.
Mm. You used to take care of my books or something, didn't you?
Come here. This man's name is John Anger. He comes from Lincoln, and he put a case in the Court of Requests in...
A property case, it was.
Be quiet. A property case in the Court of Requests in April 1526.
And got a wicked false judgment.
And got an impeccably correct judgment from our friend Sir Thomas.
No, sir, it was not.
It's not the judgment we're concerned with, but with the gift you gave the judge. Tell this gentleman about that. The judgment, for what it's worth, was the right one.
No, sir. I sent him a cup, sir. An Italian silver cup I bought in Lincoln for 100 shillings.
Did Sir Thomas accept this cup?
I sent it.
He did accept it. We can corroborate that. You can go. Go.
Is that your witness?
No, by an odd coincidence, this cup later came into the hands of Master Rich here.
How? He gave it to me.
Can you corroborate that?
I have a fellow outside who can. He was more steward at the time. Shall I call him?
No, don't bother. I know him.
When did Sir Thomas give you this thing?
I don't exactly remember.
Well, make an effort! Wait a minute. I can tell you. I know. That night we were there together in the spring. You had a cup with you when we left. Was that it?
It may have been.
Did he often give you cups?
I don't suppose so, Your Grace.
That was it then. And it was April, the April of 26, the very month that swine put his case before him. In other words, the minute he knew it was a bribe, he got rid of it.
The facts will bear that interpretation, I suppose.
Oh, this is a horse that won't run, Master Secretary.
Just a trial canter, Your Grace. We'll find something better.
Look here, Cromwell, I want no part of this.
You have no choice.
What's that you say?
The king particularly wishes you to be active in the matter.
He has not told me that.
Indeed. He told me.
But why?
We feel that since you are known to have been a friend of Moore's, your participation will show that there is nothing in the nature of a persecution, but only the strict process of law, as indeed you've just demonstrated. I'll tell the king of your loyalty to your friend. If you like, I'll tell him you want no part of it, too.
Are you threatening me, Cromwell?
My dear Norfolk, this isn't Spain.
I'm sorry, Master Cromwell. I'd forgotten he was there that night.
You must try and remember these things.
Master Secretary, I'm sincerely...
Not such a fool as he looks, the Duke.
That would hardly be possible, Secretary.
Sir Thomas is going to be a slippery fish, Richard. We'll need a net with a finer mesh.
Yes, Secretary?
We'll weave one for him, shall we? You and I?
I'm only anxious to do what is correct, Master Secretary.
Yes, Richard, I know. You're absolutely right. It must be done by law. It's just a matter of finding the right law. Or making one. Bring my papers, will you? Could we have a moment now, sir?
We don't require you after...
Oh, no, sir, but about...
Oh, yes. Well, I begin to need a steward, certainly. My household is expanding. But as I recall, Matthew, your attitude towards me in the past was somewhat... disrespectful?
Oh. I must contradict you there, sir. That's your imagination.
In those days, sir, you still had your way to make, and a gentleman in that position often imagines these things, but then when he reaches his proper level, sir, he forgets about them. Now, I don't think you find people disrespectful nowadays, do you, sir?
There may be something in that. Bring my papers. I'll permit no breath of insolence.
I should hope not, sir. Oh, I can manage that one. He's just my size. Oh, is it Thomas Morris again? Gone down a bit.
My husband is coming down, Your Excellency.
Thank you, madam.
And I beg you, be gone before he does.
Madam, I have a royal commission to perform.
You said so.
For sheer barbarity, commend me to a good-hearted Englishwoman of a certain class.
It's very cold in here, Excellency.
Yes, I remember when these rooms were warm enough.
Thus it is to incur the enmity of a king.
A heretic king? Yes, Sir Thomas is a good man.
Oh, yes, Excellency. I like Sir Thomas very much.
Carefully. Carefully.
It is very difficult dealing with him, isn't it?
Goodness can be a difficulty.
Excellency?
In the long run, of course, all good men everywhere are allies of Spain. No good man cannot be. No man who is not can be good.
Then he is really for us.
He is opposed to Cromwell, is he not?
Yes, Excellency.
If he's opposed to Cromwell, he's for us. There's no third alternative?
I suppose not, Excellency.
Oh, I wish your mother had chosen some other career for you. You've no political sense whatever. Sir Thomas. Ah, Sir Thomas. In a better state, these threadbare stuff will metamorphose into shining garments. These dank walls into walls of pearl. These cold light into perpetual sunshine.
Sounds not unlike Madrid.
Even in times like this, even now, a pleasure to converse with you.
Is this another personal visit, Chapuis, or is it official?
It falls between the two, Sir Thomas.
Official, then?
No, I have a personal letter for you.
From whom?
My master, the King of Spain. You will take it?
I will not lay a finger on it.
It is in no way an affair of state. It expresses my master's admiration for the stand which you and Bishop Fisher of Rochester have taken over this so-called divorce of Queen Katharina.
I have taken no stand.
But your views, Sir Thomas, are well known.
My views are much guessed at. Come, sir. Could you undertake to convince King Harry that this letter is in no way an affair of state?
My dear Sir Thomas, I have taken extreme precautions. I came here very much incognito, very nearly in disguise.
You misunderstand. It is not a question of your precautions, but my duty, which would be to take this letter immediately to the king.
But, Sir Thomas, your views...
are well known, you say. It seems my loyalty to my king is less so.
Render unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's...
Stop! But... Holy writ is holy, Excellency.
Look, Father, Will's getting more.
Oh, well done. Is it dry? Oh, it is. It's bracken, Your Excellency. We burn it. Alice, look at this.
Aye.
May I? This is a letter from the King of Spain. I want you to see that it is unopened. I have declined it. I want you to see that the seal is unbroken. I wish I could ask you to stay, Your Excellency. The bracken fire is a luxury.
When I must forego. Come. May I say I am sure my master's admiration will not be diminished. Ladies.
I am gratified.
The man is utterly unreliable.
Luxury.
Well, it's a luxury while it lasts. There's not much sport in this for you, is there, my dear? Alice, the money from the bishops. I can't take it. I wish... Oh, heaven, how I wish I could, but I can't.
I didn't think you would.
There are reasons.
We couldn't
come so deep into your confidence as to know these reasons why a man in poverty cannot take 4,000 pounds?
Alice, this is not poverty.
Do you know what we shall eat tonight?
Parsnips?
Yes, parsnips and stinking mutton for a knight's lady.
But at worst, we could be beggars and keep company together and be merry.
Merry.
Aye, merry.
I think you should take that money.
But don't you see? If I'm paid by the church for my writings...
This isn't about your writings. This is charity, pure and simple. Collected from the clergy, from high and low.
It would appear as payment.
And you're not a man who deals in appearances.
Oh, am I not, though? If the king takes this matter much further with me or the church, it will be very bad. Even if I appear to have been in the payment of the church.
Bad.
If you will have it, dangerous.
But you don't write against the king.
I write. And that's enough in times like these.
Well, you said there was no danger.
I don't think there is, and I don't want there to be.
There's a gentleman here from Hampton Court. He had to go before Secretary Cromwell to answer certain charges.
Oh. Well, that's all right. We expected that. When?
Now.
Alice? Alice, that means nothing. That's just technique. Well, I suppose now means now.
Can I come with you?
No. Why should you? I'll be home for dinner. I'll bring Cromwell to dinner, shall I? And serve him right.
Father, don't be witty.
Why not? Wit's what's in question.
While we are witty, the devil may enter us unawares.
Oh, he's not the devil, son Roper. He's a lawyer. And my case is watertight.
They say he's a very penetrating lawyer.
What? Cromwell? He's a pragmatist. And that's the only resemblance he has to the devil, son Roper. A pragmatist. The merest plumber.
I'm sorry to invite you here at such short notice, Sir Thomas. Good of you to come. Will you take a seat? I think you know Master Rich.
Oh, yes, we're old friends. It's a nice gown you have, Richard.
Master Rich will make a record of our conversation.
Good of you to tell me, Master Secretary.
Believe me, Sir Thomas. No, that's asking too much, but let me tell you all the same. You have no more sincere admirer than myself. But not yet, Rich, not yet.
May I hear the charges?
Charges?
I understand there are certain charges.
Oh, some ambiguities of behavior I should like to clarify. Hardly charges.
Make a note of that, will you, Master Rich? There are no charges.
Sir Thomas, you know, it amazes me that you, who were once so effective in the world and are now so much retired from it, should be opposing yourself to the whole movement of the times.
It amazes me, too.
The king is not pleased with you.
I am grieved.
Yet do you know that even now, if you could bring yourself to agree with the universities, the bishops, and the parliament of this realm, that there is no honor which the king would be likely to deny you?
I am well acquainted with his grace's generosity.
Very well. You have heard of the so-called Holy Maid of Kent, who was executed for prophesizing against the king?
Yes. I knew the poor woman.
You sympathize with her?
She was ignorant, misguided. She was a bit mad, I think. And she has paid for her folly. Naturally, I sympathize.
You admit meeting her. You met her, and yet you did not warn His Majesty of her treason. How was that?
She spoke no treason. Our conversation was not political.
My dear Moore, the woman was notorious. Do you expect me to believe that?
Happily, there are witnesses.
You wrote a letter to her.
Yes, I wrote advising her to abstain from meddling in the affairs of princes and the state. I have a copy of the letter, also witnessed.
You have been cautious.
I like to keep my affairs regular.
Sir Thomas, there is a more serious charge.
Charge?
For want of a better word.
In the May of 1526, the king published a book, a theological work. It was called A Defense of the Seven Sacraments.
Yes, for which he was named Defender of the Faith by His Holiness the Pope.
By the Bishop of Rome, or do you insist on Pope?
Bishop of Rome, if you like. It doesn't alter his authority.
Thank you. You come very readily to the point. What exactly is that authority? As regards the church in Europe, for example, the church in England, what exactly is the Bishop of Rome's authority?
You will find it very ably set out and defended, Master Secretary, in the King's book.
The book published under the King's name would be more accurate. You wrote that book.
I wrote no part of it.
I do not mean that you actually held the pen.
I merely answered to the best of my ability certain questions on canon law as put to me by His Majesty, as I was bound to do.
Do you deny that you instigated it?
It was from the first to the last the King's own project. Oh, this is trivial, Master Secretary.
I should not think so if I were in your place.
Only two people know the truth of the matter. The King and myself. And whatever he may have said to you, he will not give evidence to support this accusation.
Why not?
Because evidence is given on oath, and he will not perjure himself. If you do not know that, you do not yet know him.
Sir Thomas More, is there anything you wish to say to me concerning the King's marriage with Queen Anne?
I understood. I was not to be asked that again.
Evidently, you understood wrongly. These charges
are terrors for children, Master Secretary! An empty cupboard to frighten children in the dark! Not me!
True. True. Sir Thomas, very true. Very apt. To frighten a man, there must be something in the cupboard, must there not?
Yes. And there is nothing in it.
For the moment, there is this. I charge you with great ingratitude. I remind you of the many benefits graciously given and ill received. I tell you that no king of England ever had, nor could have, so villainous a servant, nor so traitorous a subject as yourself. The words are not mine, Sir Thomas, but the King's. Believe that.
I do. I recognize the style. So I'm brought here at last.
Brought? You brought yourself to where you stand now.
Yes. But in another sense, I was brought.
Oh, yes. You may go home now. For the present. I do not like him so well as I did. There's a man who raises the gale and won't come out of the harbor.
Do you still think you can frighten him?
Oh, yes.
What will you do?
We'll put something in the cupboard.
What?
Whatever's necessary. The King's a man of conscience and wants either Sir Thomas More to bless his marriage or Sir Thomas More destroyed.
They seem odd alternatives, Secretary.
Do they? Well, that's because you're not a man of conscience. If the King destroys a man, that's proof to the King that it must have been a bad man. The kind of man that a man of conscience ought to destroy. And a bad man's blessing's not worth having, so either will do.
I see.
Well, there's no going back, Rich. I find we've made ourselves the keepers of this conscience. And it is ravenous.
not as bad as all that.
Howard, I can't get home. They won't bring me a boat.
You blame them?
Is it as bad as that?
It's every bit as bad as that.
Then it's good of you to be seen with me.
I followed you.
Were you followed?
Probably. So listen to what I have to say. You're behaving like a fool. You're behaving like a crank. You're not behaving like a gentleman. All right, that means nothing to you. But what about your friends?
What about them?
God damn it, man! You're dangerous to know!
Then don't know me.
There's something further. I'm
sure you've realized there's a policy with regard to you. The king is using me in it.
Oh, that's clever. That's Cromwell. You're between the upper and nether millstones, then.
I am.
Howard, you must cease to know me.
I do know you. I wish I didn't, but I do.
I mean as a friend.
You are my friend!
Howard, I can't relieve you of your obedience to the king. You must relieve yourself of our friendship. No one's safe now, and you have a son.
You might as well ask a man to change the color of his hair. I'm fond of you, there it is. You're fond of me, there it is.
What's to be done, then?
Give in!
Howard, I can't. You might as well ask a man to change the color of his eye. I can't. Our friendship is more mutable than that.
Oh, that's immutable, is it? The one fixed point in a world of changing friendships is that Thomas More will not give in.
For me, it has to be. For that's myself. Affection goes as deep in me as you think, Howard, but only God is love right through. And that's myself.
And who are you? God damn it, man, it's disproportionate! We're supposed to be the arrogant ones, the proud, splenetic ones, and we've all given in. Why must you stand out? You'll break my heart.
Oh, we'll do it now, Howard. We'll part as friends and meet as strangers.
Oh, Daft, Thomas, why do you want to take your friendship from me? For friendship's sake, you say we'll meet as strangers, and yet every word you say confirms that we're friends.
That can be remedied. Norfolk, you're a fool.
You can't place a quarrel. You haven't the style.
Hear me out. You and your class have given in, as you so rightly call it, because the religion of this country means nothing to you one way or the other.
Well, that's a foolish thing for a start. The nobility of England.
The nobility of England, my lord, would have snored through the Sermon on the Mount. But you'll labor like Thomas Aquinas over a rat. Dogs? Pedigree? What's the name of those distorted creatures you're all breeding at the moment?
An artificial quarrel's not a quarrel.
No, don't deceive yourself, my lord. We've had a quarrel since the day we met. Our friendship was but sloth.
You can be cruel when you've a mind to be, but I've always known that about you.
Well, what's the name of those dogs? Bog beagles? Marsh masters?
Water spaniels!
And what would you do with a water spaniel that was afraid of water? You'd hang it! Well, as a spaniel is to water, so is a man to his own self. I will not give in because I oppose it. I do. I, not my pride, not my spleen, nor any of my other appetites, but I do. I. Is there no single sinew in the midst of all of this that serves no appetite of Norfolk's, but is just Norfolk?
Thomas.
There is, my lord. Give that some exercise. Because as you stand, you'll go before your maker in very ill condition.
Now steady, Thomas.
And he'll have to think that somewhere back along your pedigree, a bitch got a
you
wall.
You fucker!
Father, what was that?
That was Norfolk.
Do you know, sir? Have you heard? Have you told him?
Looking for you, Father.
There's to be a new act of Parliament, sir.
An act?
Yes, sir, about the marriage.
Oh.
Father, by this act, they're going to administer an oath.
An oath? On what compulsion?
It's expected to be treason.
Yes, but what is the oath?
Well, it's about the marriage.
But what is the wording?
Well, we don't need to know the wording. We know what it will mean.
It will mean what the words say. An oath is made of words. It may be possible to take it. Or avoid it. Do we have a copy of the bill?
There's one coming out from the city.
Then let's get home and say... Oh! They won't bring me a boat!
Father, he tried to hit you.
Yes. I spoke slightingly of water spaniels. Now let's get home and study this bill.
But sir.
No, Will! Will, listen. And Meg, you listen too. You know, I know you well. God made the angels to show him splendor, as he made animals for their innocence and plants for their simplicity. But man he made to serve him wittingly in the tangle of his mind. And if he should suffer us to fall to such a case that there's no escaping, well, then we may stand to our tackle as best we can. And yes, Will, then we may clamor like champions if we have the spittle for it. And no doubt it delights God to see splendor where he only looked for complexity. But it's God's part, not our own, to bring ourselves to such an extremity. Our natural business lies in escaping. So let's get home and study that bill.
Now look, I don't suppose anyone enjoyed it any more than he did. Well, not much more. Jailer. Pay rate being what it is, they have to take a rather common kind of man into the prison service. But it's a job. Yeah, a bit nearer the knuckle than most, perhaps, but it's a job like any other job. Now, they'd let him out if they could, but for various reasons they can't. I'd let him out if I could, but I can't. Not without taking up residence there myself. And he's in there already, so what would be the point? You know the old adage, better a live rat than a dead lion? And that's just about it. Well, with reference to the old adage, Thomas Cromwell was found guilty of high treason and executed on 28 July, 1540. Norfolk was found guilty of high treason and should have been executed on 27 January, 1547, but on the night of 26 January, the king died of syphilis and wasn't able to sign the warrant. Thomas Cranmer, Archbishop of Canterbury, this one here, was burned alive on 21 March, 1556. Oh, Richard Rich became a knight and solicitor general, a baron and Lord Chancellor, and died in his bed. And so did I. And so I hope with all of you. Wake up, Sir Thomas.
Oh, Mark, not again.
Sorry, sir.
Oh, what time is it?
1 o'clock, sir.
Oh, this is iniquitous.
Sir?
Yes, all right. Who's there?
Secretary, the Duke, and the Archbishop, sir.
Oh, I'm flattered. Oh.
Be seated. Oh, this is the 7th commission formed to inquire into the case of Sir Thomas More, appointed by His Majesty's Council. Have you anything to say?
No. Thank you.
Master Cromwell. Sir Thomas, do the witnesses attend?
Secretary.
Nearer. Come where you can hear. Sir Thomas, you have seen this document before.
Many times.
It is the act of succession. These are the names of those who have sworn to it.
I have, as you say, seen it before.
Will you swear to it?
No.
Thomas, we must know plainly.
Your Grace, please!
Master Cromwell! I beg your Grace's pardon. Thomas, we must know plainly whether you recognize the offspring of Queen Anne as His Majesty's heirs.
The King in Parliament tells me that they are. Of course I recognize them.
Will you swear that you do?
Yes.
Then why won't you swear to the act?
Because there's more than that in the act.
Is that it?
Yes.
Then we must find out what is in the act that he objects to.
Brilliant. God,
your grace, may I try?
Certainly. I have no pretension to be an expert in police work.
Sir Thomas, it states in the preamble that the king's former marriage to the Lady Catherine was unlawful, she being previously his brother's wife, and the Pope having no authority to sanction it. Is that what you deny? Is that what you dispute? Is that what you are not sure of?
Thomas, you insult the king and the council in the person of the Lord Archbishop.
I insult no one. I will not sign the oath, and I will not tell you why I will not.
But then your reasons must be treasonable.
Not must be, may be.
It's a fair assumption.
The law requires more than an assumption. The law requires a fact.
I cannot judge your legal standing in the case, but until I know the ground of your objections, I can only guess your spiritual standing too.
Well, if you're willing to guess at that, my lord, it should be a small matter to guess my objection.
You do have objections to the act.
Well, we know that, Cromwell.
No, you don't. You may suppose I have objections. All you know is that I will not sign. From sheer delight to give you trouble, it might be.
Is it material why you won't?
It is most material. For refusing to sign, my goods are forfeit, and I am sentenced to life imprisonment. You cannot legally harm me further. But if you were right in supposing that I had objections, and right again in supposing those objections to be treasonable, the law would let you cut my head off.
Oh, yes.
Well done, Sir Thomas. I've been trying to make that clear to his grace for some time.
Oh, confound all this! I'm not a scholar, as Master Cromwell never tires of reminding me. And frankly, I don't know whether the marriage was legal or not. But Thomas, look at these names. You know these men. Can't you do as I did and come with us for fellowship?
And when we stand before God, and you are sent to paradise for doing according to your conscience, and I'm damned for not doing according to mine, will you come with me for fellowship?
So, those of us whose names are there are damned, Sir Thomas?
I don't know, Your Grace. I have no window to look into another man's conscience. I condemn no one.
Then the matter is capable of question.
Certainly.
But what is not capable of question is your obedience to your king. So weigh a doubt against a certainty. And sign.
Some men think the earth is flat, but others think it round. It is a matter capable of question. But if it is flat, will the king's command make it round? And if it is round, will the king's command flatten it? No, I will not sign.
Then you have more regard to your own doubt than you have to his command.
For myself, I have no doubt.
No doubt of what?
No doubt of my reasons for not signing. Reasons which I will tell the king alone, and which you, Master Secretary, will not trick out of me.
Thomas.
Oh, gentlemen, can't I go to bed?
You don't seem to appreciate the seriousness of your position.
I defy anyone to live in that cell for a year and not appreciate the seriousness of their position.
Yet the state has harsher punishments.
You threaten like a dockside bully.
How should I threaten?
Like a minister of state, with justice.
Oh, justice is what you're threatened with.
Then I am not threatened.
Master Secretary, I think the prisoner may retire as he requests, unless you...
No, I see no reason to prolong this interview.
And good night, Thomas.
If I might have one or two more books.
You have books?
Yes.
I didn't know. You shouldn't have.
May I see my family?
No.
Jailer.
Sir?
Have you ever heard the prisoner speak of the king's divorce, or the king's supremacy of the church, or the king's marriage?
No, sir, not a word.
If he does, you will, of course, report it to the lieutenant.
Of course, sir.
You will swear an oath to that effect.
Certainly, sir.
Archbishop.
Place your left hand on this. Raise your right hand. Take your hat off. Now say after me, I swear by my immortal soul.
I swear by my immortal soul.
That I will report truly anything said by Sir Thomas More.
That I will report truly anything said by Sir Thomas More.
Against the king.
Against the king.
The church.
The church.
For the state of the realm.
State of the realm.
So help me God. Amen.
So help me God. Amen.
And there's 50 guineas in it if you do.
That's not to tempt you into perjury, my man.
No, sir. 50 guineas isn't tempting. 50 guineas is alarming. If he left it, it's swearing. But 50 guineas, that's serious money. Oh, if it's worth that now, it's worth my neck. Presently, I want no part of it. They can sort it out between them. I feel my deafness coming on.
Rich.
Secretary.
Tomorrow morning, remove the prisoner's books.
Is that necessary?
Norfolk, as regards this case, the king is becoming impatient.
Aye, with you!
With all of us! You know the king's impatience, how commodious it is.
Secretary?
Yes.
Sir Edvers Llewellyn has retired.
Mm.
The Attorney General for Wales. The post is vacant. You said I might approach you.
Not now. He must submit. The alternatives are bad. While Moore's alive, King's conscience breaks into fresh, stinking flowers every time he gets from bed. And if I bring about Moore's death, I plant my own, I think. There's no other good solution. He must submit! Now, the king will not permit it. We have to find some gentler way.
Wake up, Sir Thomas! Your family's here!
What's this? Oh, man! Oh, man, you can... This is... Mick,
for God's sake, Mick, they've not put you in here.
No, sir. Just a visit, a short one.
I can visit.
Yes, they'll allow me to let you out, sir.
Good morning, Father.
Good morning. Oh, good morning. Good morning, Alice. Good morning, Will.
Husband, how do you do?
Oh, as well as need be. Very happy now. Will? Oh, except it's keeping me from you, my dears. It's not so bad. Remarkably like any other place.
It drips.
Yes, too near the river.
We've bought you some things.
Oh.
Some cheese.
Cheese.
And a custard.
Those
other things.
Oh.
And this.
Oh. Is it good, Son Rover?
I don't know, sir.
Well?
Sir, come out. Swear to the act. Take the oath and come out.
Is this why they've let you visit me?
Yes. It makes under oath to persuade you.
Oh, that was silly, Meg. How did you come to do that?
I wanted to.
You want me to swear to the act of succession?
God more regards the thoughts of the heart than the words of the mouth. Or so you've always told me.
Yes.
Then say the words of the oath, and in your heart think otherwise.
But what is an oath, then, but words we say to God?
That's very neat.
You mean it isn't true?
No, it's true.
Then it's a poor argument to call it neat, Meg. Meg, when a man takes an oath, he's holding his own self in his own hands, like water. And if he opens his fingers then, well, he needn't hope to find himself again. Some men aren't capable of this. But I'd be loath to think your father one of them.
In any state that was half good, you'd be raised up high, not here for what you've done already. It's not your fault the state's three quarters bad. Then, if you elect to suffer for it, you elect yourself a hero.
Oh, that's very neat, Meg. But look now, if we lived in a state where virtue was profitable, well, common sense would make us good, and greed would make us saintly. And we'd live like animals or angels in that happy land that needs no heroes. But since, in fact, we see that avarice, anger, envy, sloth, lust, and stupidity commonly profit far beyond humility, chastity, justice, fortitude, and thought. And we have to choose to be human at all. Well, then perhaps we must stand fast a little, even at the risk of being heroes.
But in reason, haven't you done as much as God can reasonably want?
Well, finally, it isn't a matter of reason. Finally, it's a matter of love.
You're content, then, to be shut up here with the mice and the rats when you might be home with us?
Content? If they'd open a crack that wide, I'd be through it. Well, has Eve run out of apples?
I've not yet told you what the house is like without you.
Don't
what
Meg.
We do in Meg, the evenings now, you're not there.
Meg, be
we
merciful.
Sit in the dark
Meg,
because
please.
We've no candles
Meg.
And we've no talk because we're worrying about what they're doing to you in here.
The king is more merciful than you. He doesn't use the rack.
2 minutes to go, sir. I thought you'd like to know.
2 minutes?
I'm 7 o'clock, sir. I'm sorry. 2 minutes.
Jailer! Will, go to him. Keep him occupied.
How, sir?
Anyhow, have you got any money?
Yes.
No. Don't bribe him. Make him play for it. He's got a pair of dice. And talk to him. You understand. Here. Take this. And mind you share it, Will. Do it properly. Now you must leave the country. All of you must leave the country.
And leave you here?
It doesn't matter, Meg. They won't let you see me again. You must go on the same day, but different boats. Different boats from different ports.
After the trial, then?
There'll be no trial. They have no case. Do this for me. I beseech you.
Yes.
Alice, I command you.
Right.
Oh, well, I know who packed this.
I packed it.
Yes, you still make a superlative custard, Alice.
Do I?
And, well, that's a nice dress you have on.
It's my cooking dress.
Well, it's very nice anyway. Nice color.
My God, you think very little of me. I know that I'm a fool, but I'm no such fool as to at this time be lamenting my dresses or relishing complimenting on my custard.
I am well rebuked. Alice...
No!
Alice. I am faint when I think of the worst they may do to me. But worse than that would be to go with you not understanding why I go.
I don't.
Alice, if you tell me that you understand, I think I can make a good death if I have to.
Your death is no good to me.
Alice, you must tell me that you understand.
I don't! I don't understand why this had to happen!
Alice, if you say that, I don't see how I am to face it.
It's the truth.
Oh, you're an honest woman.
Much good it may do me. I will tell you what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid that when you've gone, I shall hate you for it!
Oh! Well, you mustn't, Alice!
Understanding. I understand that you are the best man that I have ever met, or am likely to. And if you must go, God knows why, I suppose. Although as God is my witness, he's been deadly quiet about it. And if anyone wants my opinion of the king and his council, they've only to ask me for it.
Why? Why, it's a lion I'm married! A lion! A lion! A lion. Say what you will. This custard is very good. It's very good.
It's no good, sir. I know what you're up to, and it can't be done.
Another minute, man.
Sorry, sir. Time's up.
For pity's sake.
Now, don't you do that, sir. Sir Thomas, the ladies will have to go now.
But you said 7 o'clock.
It's 7 now. You must understand my position.
But one more minute, please.
Only a little while. Give us a little
Mitch,
while.
Mitch, you don't want to get me into trouble.
Go as you're told.
Now, come
along,
Mitch. You'll get your father into trouble as well as me. Are you obstructing me, sir? Now, my lady, no trouble.
Don't! Put your muddy hands on me.
Am I to call the guard then? Then come on.
For God's sake, man, we're saying goodbye.
You don't know what you're asking, sir. You don't know how you've been watched.
Filthy, stinking, gutter-bred turnkey.
Call me what you will, ma'am. You've got to go.
I'll see you suffer for this.
You're not doing your husband any good.
Alice. Goodbye, my love.
You understand my position, sir? There's nothing I can do. I'm a plain, simple man and just want to keep out of trouble.
Oh, sweet Jesus! These plain, simple men!
What Englishman can behold without awe the canvas and the rigging of the law? Forbidden here the galleymaster's whip, hearts of oak in the law's great ship. Where are you going?
Oh, I'm finished here, sir.
You're the foreman of the jury.
Oh, no.
You are John Dauncey, a general dealer.
Yes.
Foreman of the jury. Does the cap fit?
Yes, sir.
Then I will apply the good plain sailor's art and fix these quicksands on the law's plain chart.
Sir Thomas More, you are called before us here in the Hall of Westminster to answer charge of high treason. Nevertheless, and though you have heinously offended his King's Majesty, We hope that you will even now forethink and repent of your obstinate opinions, that you may yet taste his gracious pardon.
My lord, I thank you. Howbeit, I make my petition to Almighty God that he will keep me in this, my honest mind, until the last hour that I shall live. As for the matters you may charge me with, I fear for my present weakness that neither my wit nor my memories will serve to make sufficient answer. I should be glad to sit down.
Be seated. Master Secretary Cromwell, have you the charges?
I have, my lord.
Then read the charge.
That you did conspire traitorously and maliciously to deny and deprive our liege, Lord Henry, of his undoubted certain title, Supreme Head of the Church in England.
But I have never denied this title.
You refused the oath tendered to you at the Tower and elsewhere.
Silence is not denial. And for my silence, I am punished with imprisonment. Why have I been called again?
To answer charge of high treason, Sir Thomas.
For which the punishment is not imprisonment.
Death comes for us all, my lords. Yes, even for kings he comes, whom amidst all their royalty and brute strength, he will neither kneel nor pay any reverence, nor pleasantly desire them to come forth, but will roughly grasp them by the very breast and rattle them until they be stark dead, so causing their bodies to be buried in a pit, and sending them to a judgment, whereof at their death their success is uncertain.
Treason enough here.
The death of kings is not in question, Sir Thomas.
Nor my own, I trust, until I am proven guilty.
Your life lies in your own hands, Thomas, as it always has.
As for our own deaths, my lord, yours and mine, dare we for shame enter the kingdom with ease when our lord entered with so much pain.
Now, Sir Thomas, you stand upon your silence.
I do.
But gentlemen of the jury, there are many kinds of silence. Consider first the silence of a man when he is dead. Let us say we go into the room where he is lying, and let us say it is in the dead of night. There's nothing like darkness for sharpening the ear, and we listen. What do we hear? Silence. What does this silence betoken? Nothing. This is silence pure and simple. But consider another case. Suppose I were to draw a dagger from my sleeve and make to kill the prisoner with it. And suppose their lordships there, instead of crying out for me to stop or crying out for help to stop me, maintained their silence. That would be token. That would be token a willingness that I should do it. And under the law, they would be guilty with me. So, silence can, according to circumstances, speak. Now consider the circumstances of the prisoner's silence. The oath was put to good and faithful subjects up and down the country, and they declared his grace's title to be just and good. And when it came to the prisoner, he refused. He calls this silence. But is there a man in this court, is there a man in this country, who does not know Sir Thomas More's opinion of the king's title? Of course not. How can that be? Because this silence betokened. Nay, this was not silence at all, but most eloquent denial.
Not so, Master Secretary. The maxim is qui tacit consentire. The maxim of the law is silence gives consent. If, therefore, you wish to construe what my silence betokened, you must construe that I consented, not that I denied.
Is that what the world, in fact, construes from it?
do you pretend that that is what you wish the world to construe from it?
The world must construe according to its wits. This court must construe according to the law.
I put it to the court that the prisoner is perverting the law, making smoky what should be a clear light to discover to the court his own wrongdoing.
The law is not a light for you or any man to see by. The law is not an instrument of any kind. The law is a causeway upon which, so long as he keeps to it, a citizen may walk safely. In matters of conscience...
The conscience. The conscience.
The word is unfamiliar to you?
By God, too familiar. I am used to hear it in the mouths of criminals.
I'm used to hearing bad men misuse the name of God. Yet God exists. In matters of conscience, the loyal subject is more bounden to be loyal to his own conscience than to any other thing.
And so provide a noble motive for his frivolous self-conceit.
Oh, pure and necessary respect for my own soul.
Your own self, you mean?
Yes. A man's soul is his self.
A miserable thing, whatever you call it, that lives like a bat in a Sunday school. A shrill, incessant pedagogue about its own salvation, but nothing to say of your place in the state, under the king, in a great native country.
Is it my place to say good to the state's sickness? Will I help my king by giving him lies when he asks for truth? Will you help England by populating her with liars?
My lord, I wish to call Sir Richard Rich. Sir Richard.
I do solemnly swear to...
I do solemnly swear that the evidence I shall give before the court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
So help me God, Sir Richard.
So help me God.
Take your stand there, Sir Richard.
Now, Rich, on 12 March, you were at the Tower.
I was.
With what purpose?
I was sent to carry away the prisoner's books.
Did you talk with the prisoner?
Yes.
Did you speak about the king's supremacy of the church?
Yes.
What did you say?
I said, supposing there were an act of parliament to say that I, Sir Richard Rich, were to be king, would not then you, Master More, take me for king? That I would, he said, for then you would be king.
Yes.
Then he said...
The prisoner?
Yes, your grace. He said, I will put you a higher case. How if there were an act of parliament to say that God should not be God?
This is true, and then you said...
Silence. Continue.
I said, but I will put you a middle case. Parliament has made our king the head of the church. Why will you not accept him?
Well...
He said Parliament had no power to do it.
Repeat the prisoner's words.
He said Parliament had not the competence, or words to that effect.
He denied the title.
He did.
Oh, truly, Rich, I am sorrier for your perjury than my peril.
Do you deny this?
Yes! My lord, if I were a man who heeded not the taking of an oath, you know well I need not be here. Now, I will take an oath. If what Master Rich has said is true, then I pray I may never see God in the face, which I wouldn't say if it were otherwise for anything on earth.
That is not evidence.
Is it probable? Is it probable that after so long a silence on this, the point so urgently sought of me, that I should open my mind to such a man as this.
Do you wish to modify your testimony?
No, Secretary.
There were two other men there, Southwell and Palmer.
Unhappily, Sir Richard Southwell and Master Palmer are both in Ireland on the King's business. It has no bearing. I have their deposition here, in which the court will see they state that, being busy with the prisoner's books, that they did not hear what was said.
Is it not obvious
that if I had said this, he would have immediately called these men to witness.
Sir Richard, have you anything to add?
Nothing, Secretary.
Sir Thomas?
To what purpose?
I am a dead man. You have your will of me. What you have hunted me for are not my actions, but the thoughts of my heart. It is a long road you have opened. For first men will disclaim their hearts, and presently they will have no hearts. God help the people whose statesmen walk your road.
And the witness may withdraw.
I have a question for the witness. That's a chain of office you're wearing. May I see it? The Red Dragon, what is this?
Sir Richard is appointed Attorney General for Wales.
For Wales? Why, Richard, it profit a man nothing to forfeit his soul for the whole world. But for Wales?
Now I must ask the court's indulgence. I have a message for the prisoner from the king. Sir Thomas, I am empowered to tell you that
no.
Even now...
No. It cannot be.
The case rests. My lord.
Then the jury will retire to consider the evidence.
Considering the evidence, it should not be necessary for them to retire. Is it necessary?
No, sir.
Then is the prisoner guilty or not guilty?
Guilty, my lord.
Prisoner at the bar, you have been found guilty of high treason.
My lords! When I was practicing the law, the manner was to ask the prisoner before pronouncing sentence if he had anything to say.
Have you anything to say?
Yes. To avoid this, I have taken every path my winding wits would find. Now that the court has determined to condemn me, God knoweth how, I will discharge my mind concerning my indictment and the king's title. The indictment is grounded in an act of Parliament which is directly repugnant to the law of God. The king in Parliament cannot bestow the supremacy of the church because it is a spiritual supremacy. And more to this, the immunity of the church is promised both in Magna Carta and in the king's own coronation oath.
Now we plainly see that you are malicious.
Not so, Master Secretary. I am the king's true subject, and I pray for him and all the realm. I do none harm. I say none harm. I think none harm. And if that be not enough to keep a man alive, then in good faith I long not to live. I have... since I've been brought to prison several times in such a state that I thought to die within the hour. And I thank our Lord I was never sorry for it, but rather sorry when it passed. Therefore, my poor body is at the king's pleasure. Would God my death might do him some good. Nevertheless! It is not for the supremacy that you have sought my blood, but because I would not bend to the merits.
Prisoner at the bar, you've been found guilty of high treason. It is the sentence of this court that you shall be taken from the court to the tower, thence to the place of execution, and there your head shall be stricken from your body, and may God have mercy on you. come no further, Thomas. Here, drink this.
My master had easel and gall, not wine, given to him. Let me be going.
Father!
Oh, have patience, Margaret. Trouble not thyself. Death comes for us all, even at our birth. Even at our birth, death does but stand aside a little and muse somewhat to himself, whether this day or the next, he will draw nigh. It is the law of nature and the will of God. You have long known the secrets of my heart.
Sir Thomas! Remember me, Sir Thomas? When you were Chancellor, you gave a false judgment against me. Remember that now.
Man, you see how I'm occupied. I remember your matter well. And I assure you that if I had to give judgment again, I should not alter it. You have no injury. So go your way and content yourself and trouble me not. Go back, Your Grace. I beseech you. Friend, be not afraid of your office. You send me to God.
You're very sure of that, Sir Thomas?
He will not refuse one who is so blithe to go to him.
Behold! The head of a traitor.
I'm breathing. Are you breathing too? It's nice, isn't it? It's not difficult to keep alive, friends. Just don't make trouble. Or if you've got to make trouble, make the sort of trouble that's expected. Well, I don't need to tell you that.
Good night. If we happen to bump into one another, recognize me.